So welcome back to the ELITS Digital Pharma Summit. We will now be heading into the second panel discussion of the day on pharma CIOs creating new business processes by embracing automation. Joining us for the discussion, we have Mr. Ganesh Ramachandran, Global Chief Information Officer, Alkem Laboratories, who will be moderating this session. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
We also have in the panel Mr. Sanjay Nandavardikar. I'm sorry for the pronunciation.
I know it's pretty difficult.
Director IT Cipla. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
Global and Group Chief Information Officer, Aurobindo Pharma. Welcome, sir, to the discussion. And Dr. Avadhoot Parab, Global CIO, Workhard Limited. Pleased to have you here, sir.
Thank you.
I would request Mr. Ramachandran to take over the session, sir. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Garima. And at the outset, I must let all the participants know that one of the people who were to join us on the panel, Mr. Ravi Kala from Anthem, is unable to make it. He's had some emergency, so he will not be joining us. So it will be the three key panelists that we have here, Dr. Parab, Mr. Pandey, and Mr. Nandavardikar, who would be helping go through some of the questions that we've got. At any point in time, if you feel that you have anything that you would like to ask, you've got a lovely high-power panel over here, so please feel free to chip in with your questions. But first of all, thank you all for joining the session, and thank you to the team ELITS for having all of us over here. The last few years have seen a lot of automation that has really come through, and it's been right across the value chain, whether it be looking to improve the time to launch at R&D, whether it's been increased supply chain efficiencies, changes in the front office processes. We've been seeing all of this coming through and more. Along the way, we've also seen massive changes in the way we work. So there's been a lot more hybrid working, which I'm sure all of us have been seeing. Amongst the team that is on the panel here, Sanjay is the only lucky one who's still working from home. The rest of us, Avadhoot, Gyan, and me are all at office. But we have been seeing a lot more of a mix of in-office and remote kind of working. And that also has meant a lot more collaboration tools like the platform we are on now. And that's also extended right through the value chain, whether it is the way we engage with doctors, whether we doctors engaging with their patients. We've seen all of this coming through. At Alkem, for instance, some of you may be aware, we had launched a first of its kind platform for doctors to set up their virtual clinic and to engage with their patients called Connect to Clinic that we launched in June of 2020. However, there's no doubt that CIOs and the tech teams have ensured business continuity right through the pandemic, whether it was ensuring the availability of infrastructure, putting in applications, strengthening information security, keeping a close tab on it. We've seen all of this kind of happen right through the pandemic. And the proof of all this, I think each of you would agree, is heightened by the exponential increase that all of us are seeing from business users right across. And just before the session, we were talking amongst the panel that automation and digital transformation are all center of all the discussions, and the tech teams are seen as instrumental in making this happen. So the topic that we will be discussing today with this eminent panel is on creating new business processes by embracing automation. What we will get the panel to talk about is to share their thoughts on the topic, what automation they have seen across the value chain, new processes that have emerged, challenges, learnings, requirements to succeed, and we'll also try and do a little bit of crystal ball gazing into the future. I'm very eager to hear all their thoughts, as I'm sure you are, so we'll quickly get into it. But just before we start the first question, would be great if each of you can add your questions whenever anything comes up. If you feel you want to throw any questions at the panel, please feel free to put it in the chat window, and the ELITS team will pass it across to us, and we will take it up as we go along. So I'd like to start by opening the topic to the panel, and we'll go in alphabetical order. So we'll start with Dr. Avadhoot Parab, then we'll go to Gyan Pandeyji, and then we'll come to Sandeyji for their thoughts on the topic and what they see as the real increase in automation in the pharma industry. What are the key priority areas to their mind for automation? Dr. Parab?
Okay, hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thank Ganesh for setting up a context. And yes, pharma is looking, automation definitely is a wider word, but what is happening is the focus of automation today we see in pharma is without disturbing the compliance grid, how can you increase efficiency and effectiveness of the process? So this has been, and of course, when we say compliance grid, it stands for patient safety, data integrity, product quality. So this remains the at the backbone without, and regulator is at the back. Now, when we are looking at this, there are many automations which we are seeing industry looking into a supply chain area. And the supply chain, when we say from sourcing to distribution, because one is you get a right material. The industry is now looking at not getting the right material, but getting the right material when to buy. Now, we have gone to that level. Because that is where, if your sourcing is the only area where you can really hit the, P&L, because that's one of the major income sides. So if we can do a guided buying with a good kind of, when to buy or sourcing strategy with the using a technology today and with external data and all, that area is getting automated without much human intervention. And what is that getting automated is the maverick buying is getting challenged today in the supply chain. And when we say, I'm using a little harsh word, but it is many a time it is a personal judgment or professional judgment. No, it is good to buy now and all kind of thing. But system will tell you, okay, this is not the right time to buy. This may be. So we are moving towards from buying now to when to buy. So this is another big change which you're seeing from the efficiency perspective, and definitely it is going to have huge impact on what we say is a P&L, because that's one item. We also see a visibility coming before we get into a process automation, visibility becoming one of the ask and of the management, so that we know if there is a float in particular process, how can we take that float and reduce the lead time to attack the turnaround time. So this is another area which is also getting very much addressed as far as supply chain. Manufacturing, yes, the industry is looking for increasing the yield without getting into a capex mode or increasing the capacity, physical capacity, with studying the data. How do I increase my yield and sustain that yield? So that's another area. When we sustain, which means you're moving from you're predicting the process, and the system becomes an advisory kind of thing. So we're moving from that kind of automation is getting into that quality. Every company has seen the majority of the systems, whether it is LIMS to many people have QMS systems, DMS or LMS. So that ecosystem is already there. So how this ecosystem can be an assistant to manufacturing, so that again the lead time decreases, the availability increases, the production can be real predictable to see, and this particular commit can be given to sales team for availability to promise. So these are some of the areas, and of course R&D is becoming more technology inviting from the discovery area, where we have seen a huge change. Earlier it was more of a human thinking and the domain knowledge of it. Today you have a lot of models which are helping you for therapeutics. Given a therapeutic segment, how can you discover? And the last point, when you really want to create a report from post your clinical trial, you have today natural language generation, natural language processing. So all in all, we are now talking about how do we make IT as a profit center? How can we use those small element, whether it is a lead time, whether it is a repetitive process being moved to a digital agent? How do we increase the efficiency? How can I, where is that my dollar is stuck, and how can I release that dollar so that my working capital become better, cash flow becomes better? So this is what we have seen happening in the recent past, Ganesh. That's from me.
Superb, Dr. Parab. I think you have touched across so nicely on all the supply side areas, and you have covered right from, taking it through from the variation in demand and how supply chain is so important and the efficiency that really comes into it. You addressed a few technology areas as well along the way you spoke about it. And we'll come back and pick your thoughts on a little later. But let me move across to Mr. Gyan Pandey now. Gyanji, your thoughts on what are the things that you're seeing automation really driving? What are the increases in automation you're seeing? What are priority areas that you're seeing for automation in pharma?
Thank you, Ganesh, and thanks also. I think the both people have put the right context and the impact on this. I think many of the
things. Yeah, if you could just come a little closer to the mic, your audio is slightly, you know.
Is it better?
Yeah, it's echoing. It's echoing.
Would you want to try it?
Is it better? Can you hear me?
Oh, yes, much better now. Thank you.
Okay. So now coming back to the opportunities of how things are evolving in the pharma in terms of automation sector, I think Adhok has already covered most of the points. And this is happening across, I will say, the end-to-end, whether supply chain, manufacturing, drug discovery, patient-doctor interactions and collaborations. You already talked about that, of the Alchem launching one platform for the doctor-patient collaborations. Same is happening on the clinical trials and drug development and drug discovery. But when we talk about precisely, let's say, coming down to the manufacturing, there are still a lot of things which has evolved and which is still in the process. And this pandemic has basically, I will say that accelerated that those adoptions and taking those automations in a faster way, because that is needed for the business. So we know that in the manufacturing side, you will have a function-specific or process-specific solutions. And based on that, the process-related decisions were taken. So one of the things which has evolved in the last 2-3 years across the pharma companies, depending on the size and their IT install base and landscape, to integrating those where maybe across the functions, if you have to take the decisions and insights. I will give you a simple example, like you will have a LIM system which will be there, and then you will have a QMS system and ERP running separately, and maybe you will have the supply chain also running separately in the CRM. These definitely needs to talk to each other, and there has been a lot of initiatives in all the organizations to bring that visibility across the processes so as right decisions can be taken. And that brings a lot of efficiency in terms of the process or in terms of removing any kind of float which is there from one department to other department. Second part is that this also helps that, okay, on the leadership level or the strategic level or a tactical level, it brings the visibility of that, which process or where we need to focus more to bring that efficiency. So first was the system-wise integrations, which in any case pre-pandemic also was there, but it also gathered further momentum. To bring that insight. And while doing this course of this integrations and automations, there has been clear identifications of some of the pain areas for which you'll have another bolt-on solutions. And that bolt-on solutions, now I think if you take any approach in any manufacturing industry or any vertical, when you take any solutions, it is no more kind of a process-centric or a function-centric solutions. You need to think of the backward and forward integration so as it will bring a lot more insight in terms of decision-making. The third part is that, okay, when we started during the pandemic time, that all pharma companies were tremendous pressure to still maintain their productivity or enhance it. And they have to be flexible enough to change the product lines and all depending on the demand in the market. At the same time, they will have a severe challenge in terms of maintaining the supply chain, getting the sourcing out done and all. So supply chain for most of the pharma companies, that has been a point of, I will say, great focus where we can do the automations. And to the my understanding experience, what I have had in the last 6-7 years being in the pharma is that that's the one area where probably we can do a lot more optimizations by doing the automations. We talk about supply chain towers, and we talk about how pharma industry can come closer to the just-in-time kind of inventory in the discrete manufacturing like auto or something. Maybe not to that extent, but pursuit towards that will definitely bring a lot more efficiency and a lot more insight in the supply chain. And supply chain is one which, if you take the Indian pharma industry, which is apart from the domestic market, they also have the potential export growth. And we work in the model that we'll have manufacturing capacity here, and we'll have overseas entities, which will be basically the marketing and distribution. And in this whole process, when you manufacture here, send the good to the your overseas, and then there it will go for the quality releases, and then it will go to the that geography, it will become a sellable product. This leads to a huge inventory piling up. And all companies, pharma companies, are working towards that, how we can make our
inventory more efficient. And this directly impacts your cash flow and your financial performance. So supply chain is one area where we all, we have seen that, okay, how you can plug the gaps, which is currently not automated, and then taking the corrected data and bringing the insight and decision making to make it more efficient. On the shop floor side also, again, there has been, issues related to data integrity, patient safety, product quality, and there has been all the SOPs being defined, and if there is any deviations and all, that gets captured. So one part is how we can integrate and bring those through the digitalizations or automations, those kind of helping hand to the people who are performing on the shop floor, either they are executor or the reviewer or the final approvers, irrespective of that, how we can enable them that these mistakes or these deviations can be avoided. There is one area where, depending on the organization's process maturity or the IT landscape or what is the current business problems, based on that, that priority can be taken. But that is one area which is currently being in the automations and all. Third part is that then you need to bring actionable insights, and that is not only from your internal applications or internal process and system, that also needs the inputs from the external, whether it is a supplier side, customer side, or market at large, maybe geography, maybe molecule, maybe compliance. And those things, maybe wave two will be coming once your internal process is being integrated and all, where you can have visibility that in certain, let's say in case of certain molecule, how you're performing, how your supply chain is effective, how your production is effective, how you are cost-wise doing this, and benchmarking it with others, not only within your peers in the country, but also internationally, which will make you more competitive. And then probably also giving this idea that, okay, which are the market which is still untapped and we have the potential to do better than most of the competitions. That will also come all through this. And I think the whole thing will lead towards that. And once this automations reaches to a certain level, the flexibility in the manufacturing, which we keep on talking about, the continuous manufacturing concept in the pharma, which is still kind of a long way to go, because we have something called clinical validations and all, cleaning validations, which is one of the showstopper in terms of compliance and all. These things will also maybe coming a few years down the line. And we also see there is a lot of changes happening from the regulatory sides, FDAs, how we are going to basically do the validations and also related to the, if you're automating on the IoTs. And we also see that, okay, now the whole CSV is now moving towards CSA, which will bring a lot of shift from the tons of documents and the papers and maybe records which we maintain in order to comply to the audit, and is still missing out some of the important part, the assurance, that will also come out in this.
Superb, thank you again, sir. So I love the way you kind of talked about the whole intelligent enterprise kind of coming to life, where you were talking of integrations right across different parts of it and making sure that everything came together. And both you and Dr. Parab have alluded to this part of actionable insights. We will pick up the threads on that as well as we go along. Let me move to Sanjay ji. Sanjay, your thoughts on, your opening thoughts on this, what would be the kind of areas that you see has increased in terms of automation in the pharma industry, and priority areas as for what you are seeing?
Yeah, let me confirm if I'm audible.
Yes, sure.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. I think Gyan has covered elaborately, I think every area, every aspect of the pharmaceutical industry, and Avadhut also has taken a complete purview of what we are doing in terms of automation, what could be the automation areas. I'll take a very short time just to put forward my thoughts. Basically, the automation had changed a major version. If you consider pre-pandemic situation and post-pandemic situation, if we are considering automation 1.0, in pre-pandemic situation, now it is automation 2.0. Reason being, we've been forced to apply the automation in a different way during the pandemic situation. And all of us know and experience that the sourcing of the material, particularly from China, for all the Indian pharmaceutical companies was very difficult, particularly during the pandemic situation, which has forced us to think differently and think about different sources altogether. That too, without having a physical connect with the other companies, without having a physical route. So that means everything was challenged in terms of how we can go and move to a next process or an alternate process. I think that is one of the areas where automation has indirectly forced us to think differently and create the processes which are not there in the history, right? This is one of the area where automation has major impact. Second, I think the connectivity. We have experienced in the pandemic that we were not allowed to work in offices. And within a couple of days, we need to give the accessibility to all our workforces. I think the tools what we have used during the pandemic were there right in pre-pandemic area, but those were not tested, those were not applied. And this situation has given us to ride on the automation, bring that all digital and automated way to make people connect to the workforces or workbenches. Third area, which is measure, is reaching out to the customers, right? During the pandemic situation where you're not allowed to go to the doctors physically, you have to invent a new process wherein you would be connected with the doctors. Of course, we were talking about doctor detailing and other things through the app, but pre-pandemic and post-pandemic, there is a huge difference, there's a sea difference. The way we are approaching the doctor and the way doctors are adopting the technology, the automation is completely different. 360 degree change in the approach of the doctors and in the approach of our field forces as well. So if I summarize all these things, of course, Gan and Avadhoot has covered it in a detailed way. But if I summarize this, the automation, the thought process of automation has completely changed. Now the automation is no more of optimizing the current processes. Automation is more of creating a new process altogether, thinking differently, challenging the existing processes, creating alternative to the processes, yet being compliant in the pharmaceutical industry. So this is short things, what I think about the automation in current situation. Of course, we'll be unveiling a couple of other examples, or we would be talking about a few more areas where we can bring automation in a different shape and form as we proceed with the conversation.
Absolutely. Thank you, Sanjay. I think the points you made on saying that many of the tools, I think it's so true when you were saying, I was just reflecting, we did have many of the tools earlier too, but somewhere the acceptance was really not that much. And I think the pandemic forced people to start taking a look and saying, hey, is there a better way of doing what we are doing? And why don't we do this? Starting with things as simple as collaboration tools. So you're absolutely bang on. I think many of those we started seeing, and you are right. I think it is no longer just about I think both Gyan and Avadhoot mentioned it. It's no longer just about saying that I want an efficiency improvement. You're now moving beyond to saying that I want to provide you an additional layer for you to take a decision. I want you to have more predictive kind of things where I can tell you that this is what you should be looking at and make it a lot more data-driven and insight-driven. So absolutely fabulous thoughts to hear it. I just want to pick up a quick question that came from the audience where someone has asked saying that, and I think this is so true, that we have seen a lot of the things coming in. There's a lot more automation there, a lot more demand on the IT teams. There's a question that's come from the audience saying, so what kind of reskilling has been needed because of all these automation initiatives that have been coming through? What are your thoughts on that, gentlemen?
Can I take that?
Please, yeah. I think each of you can share your views on it.
Okay, so this has been, I won't say a challenge, but this is an opportunity for re-looking at the so-called IT department, as IT or digital department going forward. So we have been looking always that can we reskill the people from IT department. But I don't think that's become a very, very small window of skill, upskilling or reskilling kind of people. But we need to look at across the organization, because digital as the initiative, it is less of IT, more of a process or the process owners. Now with this as a picture, we have to look at not only just skilling, but also the awareness session from the top of the pyramid to the bottom of the pyramid. And this is where we think we should, one of the method or approach we would recommend here is, and we have just tried this, and I think it is a little effective. You can, for the senior management, you can, if the moment you say that you will be given training through some kind of IIMs or some kind of ISBs of the group, so on the digital front, and you have been given certificates, and that's one part of it. So they get charged. the middle management or the operational people, I think you should have a little hands-on. When you talk about digital, it just cannot be a technology training, but you need to upskill the people on the statistic front, on the measurement front. How do you look at the data, data science side of it? So that is another area which we need to look at it. So and third one is how you can take the advantage of so many forums happenings which are available free. There are the CIO club is also promoting a lot of upskilling programs which are been NASSCOM and they take it. So I would say the provider ecosystem of upskilling the resources is available. We need to do map the whole organization, because you need to move from where you are from the thinking perspective. It is like technology, process or people, but it is mindset, skill set and people set. So if that triangle needs to be re-looked at it to upskill. And then these are some of the areas, if you look at it, make a more of a certificate program, and that will serve. And it is indeed required, without which starting a digital will go to some level and it will not be acceptable. They will not be, the users will not be able to perceive it, or the process owners will not be able to perceive it, and the project will get into iteration and it will get dropped down. So these are some of the areas which we can look at it.
Super, Dr. Parab. I loved your the ones that you kind of talked about, the mindset, skill set, and people set. I'm going to steal that and use that in some of our future sessions. Very nice. I really like that. Thank you. Gyanji and Sanjay, any other thoughts from your side?
Yeah, I will just add one thing which out of the very nice sunlight.
Gyan, can you come near mic, Gyan? Maybe you can use headphone if it is there.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Better now.
And I think there's some problem with my mic for that. So just to add what very well summarized by Oro, this pillars
of mindset, skill set, and people set. I think this mindset, skill set, and skill set can, there is an ecosystem, there could be initiative. People can upskill, they can reskill, or to some extent unlearn, not de-skill, some of the existing practices and processes. But mindset and people set are very important. And I connect mindset and people set together, because this two together becomes your cultural set. The way you look in your existing process and the way you look in when you are going for distillations is completely different. I may be going a step beyond this, the way your whole organization structure or function process is, that also needs to be revisited if you are going for in that set. But I think that is still way forward. But one important thing is that from IT side, I will put that earlier, if there is an implementation of a ERP or CRM, you know that you are going to implement for a function specific. There could be one piece of integrations or one piece of reporting in that particular function silo. From IT side also, when we are moving for any solutions, it could be for a specific piece of process or entire function. But we need to think from the user aspect that, okay, if the different level of users will have a different level of demand for the data, they may look for data from the QMS there, they may look for data from the LIMS there, they may look for data from the pharmacovigilance there, if that is relevant for their function. So we need to understand that in their function, if this is fitting, what are the other areas which they will be referring for making any decision or actions? And can we also enable, not immediately in the phased manner? So this will give a more visibility, and then adoption could be better. Because most of the times when you implement a system, it gives only a piecemeal solution, and end user on the operation level who are the real critical for the success and adoption, they will feel that 60% of my work is still going outside the system. And that is where at some point of time, if you don't focus on that, probably your implementation will not yield the objective what you intended for. So there should be a constant effort, and it's a continuous effort to keep evolving and re-evolving and making the adoption successful.
Fantastic. Thank you, sir. So yes, absolutely. I think it is all about making sure you view things holistically, and you do take all the different kind of requirements that are there and put them together. So don't view it in a piecemeal manner. Absolutely point bang on. Sanjayji, your thoughts on...
Yeah, so I think Ganesh, reskilling is already started. I think almost all our organization has understood that we have to reskill our resources. Now, reskilling is happening on a different layer at a different level, right? Digital is no more a monopoly of IT anymore, right? It is basically a democratized way of data. Now, business need to understand data and IT need to understand the business. The gap between business and IT has already been vanished, right? Yep. And then I think this is most important stage where we need to have a reskilling of the resources. I, as an IT person, need to understand what processes are and how the processes are working, right? And as a process owner, as a business, they need to understand how data can be seen, right? I think reskilling is also happening at the organization level where the skill of collaboration is reinstilled now. During the pandemic, we have seen that multiple teams came together and they delivered the project. Now, this was happening in bits and pieces in last couple of years, but now the collaboration is the skill which has been taught in the organization at very high level. What it means that whenever I'm working on a piece of work, I really need to understand who is a supplier of my work and who is a customer of my work. For example, if I'm doing a R&D, I need to understand the manufacturing would be using this R&D piece. At the same time, supply chain is my supplier who would be giving us the materials. Now, considering all this aspect, now the people should understand and they should be skilled or reskilled, whatever you call it, to think holistically, not as an individual person contributor, but holistically as an organization, as a department, that what would be the impact of my work, how it is going to be impacting on the further piece of the work, which would be taken care of by somebody else. And that is where the whole reskilling need to happen. I touch upon the point where Gan and others mentioned there has to be unlearning as well. Because we are working in the industry almost for a decade or so, we have our mindset that this is how it is going to work, or this is how it has worked for last 10 years. Does it mean it won't be true as of now as well? Because we are already on a wave of automation, already on a wave of digitalization. Things are changing dramatically. Now, no more like a pharmaceutical company are only companies who are selling the product of pharmaceutics, right? The chemical products. There are companies who do not have footprint in manufacturing, who do not have footprint in any other operational areas, but still they are selling the product of the product which was manufactured by the pharmaceutical company. These are the disruptive drivers which are coming in the pharmaceutical industry. And hence, I think the reskilling need to happen at every layer of the organization, which fortunately has started. I think there are a lot of programs which all the organizations have taken for reskilling the workforces to their areas. At the same time, at the knowing people that, look, you're not only responsible for your work, but you are responsible for the whole organization. Because, if you're not contributing to your work, understanding the whole gamut of the bigger picture, then probably you'll be doing just a day job and you're going home. But if you're thinking about a bigger picture, you might be adding a lot of values to your work. And that is where the reskilling need to happen. Of course, from a technology side, how to read the data and all the things, there are a lot of means and mediums which are available on internet. There are a lot of courses which are available on internet. Organizations are sponsoring on the courses, but you need to create that mindset. So using a tool is not a difficult job, but creating the mindset to use the tool is a difficult job. And that is where I think the whole initiative would start, and rather it has started to make our workforce so skilled that they would be understanding the holistic picture and using the tools which are available to create the larger picture, larger impact of their work. So that is my take on this
question. Sure, Sandhya, I think you touched upon so nicely on the part of how collaboration becomes so important, and the fact that today the boundary between a process person and a technology person is just completely blurred. Both sides needs to understand each other, without which you really can't get an initiative to go through successfully. Very well laid out. There is another question, and each of you had spoken about this, so I'm going to kind of turn the thing and start from Sanjay, go to Gyan, and then come to Avdhoot. Each of you spoke about data. The question is, well, the audience is asking, how can analytics and automation be combined? And while the question is more around effective supply chain, I would leave it across, because I think the analytics piece is something with a lot of data coming in with more automation. It is something which is true right across. So if each of you want to share your thoughts on what are the things that you're seeing on how automation is driving more use cases for analytics, I think the point that was made earlier was it is not just about descriptive or even prescriptive analytics. Some you're going a lot more predictive, you're losing a lot more AI, those kind of things. So if you could just touch upon what are the kind of things that you're seeing on analytics, perhaps you could take different areas and talk about it. That would be lovely. given the experience that we have across the panel. So Sanjay, starting with you.
Sure. Little digression, but I was having a WhatsApp circulation. There was a video of a boat hive, a robot hive, which was from a food company in Southeast UK, I believe. They have a warehouse of nearly about 7 football grounds. It is as big as that. And they have 86,000 SKUs or products. Everything has been managed by the boats. So the boats are working in so seamless fashion that the boats are traveling with each other with 5 mm of distance, and they are picking and pushing the product in particular basket and bucket. Now boat can't be running on their own, right? You need to have a data which should be driving the boats, and that is where the analytics and automation works together. So they are having a cognitive analytics which is running behind the hive. And they call it as a hive mind. And in the mind, they have multiple algorithms which are working for channelizing the robots. And based on the demand, based on the supply, and based on the whole SCM piece, they have created the algorithms which allows the bots to pick up the goods and put it in a basket. This is a fantastic video. I think I will forward that video to each one of you. This is the best use case I have ever seen as of now. But that is a destination. I think that is where every industry is trying to move. Though it is not so, at a current situation, though it's not so true in India, but very soon we would be probably moving there. But as of now, I think the whole automation would be driven by the analytics and the AI. Basically, when you're talking about the machine connections or IoTPs for that matter, I think baseline is your data. How the data is managed at your end, how the algorithms are managed at your end, basis that your whole piece of automation will work. A couple of basic things probably we need to understand is still we are working on a processes which are probably age old. Do we really automate or do you really want to automate those processes? Or can you have a different look on the process altogether? Here I'm bringing the point of looking at the processes in a different way altogether, right? If you are thriving to have a new process altogether, and if you want to test certain new processes altogether, bring in the automation, I think that would give a lot of value for your organization versus automating the processes which are already there. I think the biggest benefit and the biggest ROI, what you can count, is having alternate processes which can complement or rather replace your current processes. I'm not saying that all your processes are outdated, but I think it is a time to have a closer look on your processes, whether still this process would be, probably we can continue with the process for next 10 years where the whole system would be digitalized, whole system would be automated. And that is where I think we need to think as an organization, orchestrate the future of automation and work accordingly. But at the same time, I think your data layer has to be very solid. You really need to understand your pulses of the organization through the data, and basis that you need to define your strategy for automation.
Super. Thank you, Sanjay. Gyanji, over to you. And just if you could add, building on what Sanjay just about talked about, saying that you'll need to have a strong data layer in place, given that you now have a lot of data that is coming through. And if you're talking of both you and Dr. Parabit spoken about it at the plant levels, where you have data from OT that is there, you have different kinds of equipment that is there, which is throwing out data. What is the way in which you see the whole thing of a BW, data lake, those kind of things as well evolving when you're looking at an analytics thing kind of coming through? If you could touch upon that, that will also be very helpful to kind of understand.
Sure, Ganesh. Sanjay has very well given this, what the future is going to be. And pharma is a very, very data-rich industry. And
every steps of every process, especially on the manufacturing and operations and quality, we have tons of data, but most of the data, majority of the data is in the unstructured format, whether it's a paper, whether it's a manual, or in a silo systems, even if it is a QMS, LIMS, SCADA, it will be in the HPLCs, it's on the silo system. Then you have some of your other function related data, which is more structured data, ERP, CRM, supply chain, your value chain planning and all, that is more structured data. And on that, most of the organizations, they have already on the stage where they can do their business intelligence or actionable insights to take this. Now, I think there has been so much of automations and connected devices we have been working on. Most of the companies, they are either in the phase of implementing MES or they will be adopting MES sooner or later, where most of your manufacturing equipment will get connected. Your LIMS solution is no more that where you are capturing certain process-related data. It is also connected to the devices. Your R&D is also moving towards the most more or less paperless kind of scenario. So there is a lot of, again, initiatives going within, I will say, some of the sub-processes within that particular segment. And when we talk about the data lake, we talk about getting all this data, structured, unstructured, because now we have the technology which can decipher many of the unstructured data, handwritten manuscripts also. You have the NLP and all, which can basically decipher that and bring the insight about the data. So I think the journey one and the evolution where it is going towards, and because it is not going to happen, this analytics, advanced analytics, which you're talking about immediately, it depends on the process maturity, digital maturity, and also what is the business need for that organization, whether in terms of the quality or the process efficiency, and it will save in that way. And but one thing is very clear, that scenario like data lake, where we pull together all the data, connect it together, and once we reach to that stage, also connect the external data to bring a lot more insights. And that journey could start first bringing the visibility or insight, suggesting you to take the right actions, then reaching to a cognitive stage that you know if A plus B is going to happen, C plus D is going to be the outcome. Then more maturity and the seasonality and the time index of the data, you will reach to the kind of predictive in some of the processes, whether it is maintenance, whether it is the quality of the drug, whether it is the yield of the product. You can reach to that stage where you can predict the things so as corrective actions can be started before reaching to that outcome. And that will reduce your risk of the quality failures or the any deviations what we are very familiar in the production scenarios. And maybe over the year, we can reach to a stage where it will be a more kind of prescriptive, where all these processes, data taken together, it will give you that is what took the golden ways or the golden batch for this, what could be the finest calibrations, because now we do go into the manual way and we define SOPs and we do calibrations with the range. But in that range, there could be something which will be the best configurations for the given equipment or a given product set. So that analytics will reach over a period, because this distillation and analytics coming together with whatever the technology available, it has a lot of resemblance to the human learning also. As a child, we grow, we start learning about the environments, we start understanding the verbal things, and then we study, read, experience, and based on that, the adoption happens. The only difference is that in case of humans, it's very subjective, depending on the orientation, they gather the knowledge, and given a scenario, the decisions of the two people could be two different ways. But in case of the analytics, if the algorithms are defined to the or tuned to the certain way, the outcome will be always the same. And it has an ability to correct. And once you correct, it will again, in that scenario, take the right decisions. So currently we are moving, we are in the phase one, where we're talking about gathering together, journey towards that to a scenario like data lake, where you'll have the complete visibility of your process, your structured and unstructured data, which will ensure that, okay, your compliances in terms of your SOPs, in terms of your patient safety, your quality can be addressed better, or you can take your corrective and preventive actions before the eventuality comes, and that makes you more efficient and competitive.
Thank you, Gyan. I think you laid it out so nicely that this is, you know, it is not a one size fits all. It depends on the maturity level that the organization is at, the priorities that the organization has, and basis that you kind of lay out the path on where you want to go. The first step, like you rightly pointed out, is on making sure you have right, clean data, and then look for what connections you're kind of wanting to get to build a model that will kind of help you. So bang on, sir, very well laid out. Abdut, we heard Sanjay talking about distribution. We heard Gyan talking about the manufacturing parts. I'm going to throw two of the questions that have come from the audience towards you. One was, you spoke initially about the supply chain parts and how analytics and automation are really coming together. So if you could elaborate a little more on that and share what are the kind of things that you're seeing which is helping and building a more effective supply chain. And I know, you know, from some of the past conversations that we have had in forums we've been part of, on how much you look at analytics in terms of the compliance areas and how you look at automation there. If you could cover both of those, that would be lovely.
Okay, thank you. And I think Gyan and Sanjay has covered majority, at least all the touch points. Quickly coming back, and it's very simple rule, analytics is an input to automation. So that's a way we look at it. There was a time when rows and columns moved to some graphical, dashboarding, which we say descriptive. But I don't think that is going to sustain. And in the days where the margins is going getting less and less, and there's a lot of pressure on the competitive pressure, you need to come out with a model where can you be cheapest manufacturer of anything and everything. So with this, there are constraint of compliance of you can't just change the vendor as your whims and fancy. So you have a regulated in a regulated environment, you need to stick to a vendor, you need to stick to the way you are buying and so within that also, is there a way you can still look at some of the indirect buying or some other categories of the buying? Can you see whether the systems can be a great digital assistant? And for this, you need to have something, a visibility. And for that, we now, the concept of control tower is in discussion. So can we have a control tower of supply chain where it will not only give you a visibility, but it will be a very predictive part embedded into it. There's a lot of intelligence, and it will be just a companion of a user and digital assistance. Okay, you're taking decision, but these are the risks. These are the areas where you need to look in. So it'll be a more of a guided buying. Earlier we used to have Amazon guided buying, but this will be guided buying with all the historical information. So control tower is becoming one of the area which is coming up now, and every process which you do it will have a digital twin in the control tower kind of thing. So you will see and supply chain is all about can I reduce the lead time. So the moment my lead time is reduced, my working capital control comes up, because working capital components are all with supply chain, majority inventory and creditors at least. So these are this one area I think becoming important part of it. On the side of the compliance, as Gyan mentioned, the GAM-5 moving towards assurance-based compliance, and it gives you a lot of flexibility, saying what is critical and not critical, which can be defined by the organization, given the therapeutic segment, given the market, given the product or the line and the process which you are doing. You can say you only provide the evidence for what is critical, and what is not critical, you have the flexibility of not documenting everything. So with this change happening, all those testing tools which otherwise we used to take that as not a comfort zone, now all those tools can be really come as a rescue for this, and that part if can automation. Now in a pharmaceutical company, you see validation is a major area of focus, and you have a lot of people there, you have the documents piling up, you have issue of retrieving the right document, right version. Some site is running with some different version. And so there are a lot of complications which will come. So is there a way you can look at all of the validation process which we can do it through a digital tool? It could be any of the electronic validation and all. That can be a great, relief to the whole organization, availability anytime. And you don't need to search for. And so, and this is gaining a lot of momentum now with the CSA coming in. I'm sure in a year or so, when we again meet up, you will see many people moved up from manual validation to this. So these are a few areas I would like to touch, which are really in demand. Others are going on with the LIMS automation, taking the LIMS to intelligent LIMS, and all of those are going on. But these are the focus sectors.
Well, just to add what Avadhoot mentioned, Ganesh.
Yeah.
I think now the audits became virtual. It is very, I think, necessary for us to think in a different way for our compliance. Basically, moving the compliance from paper to digital is I think, the need of the hour. because there would be certain limitation when you are facing the virtual audits, right? You can't really run around the piece of papers and grab it and show it on the screen. So rather giving access to the auditors, and this can be, I think, a point of our next discussion somewhere, but giving rights to the auditor for having the audit on the compliance document could be a next stage where we can evolve as a companies in terms of digitalization. I think this is a journey which we need to start together. And I think at some point in time, I think we will be starting on that journey. But Avadhoot pick up it very well that we really need to think a little differently on the compliance and the management of the compliance, particularly from record retention side, record retrieving side, and other aspect of the documentation.
Very valid point, Sanjay. Absolutely. I think that is where we are. I think across the industry, this is something that what you're saying, I think, will gain prominence because you are seeing auditors increasingly asking for it. And they are saying, if you can give us access to your system, we'll take that. So absolutely. So if we can just get that going, nothing like it, rather than they querying and then we providing the right kind of proof that you need to show them for. Bang on. I realized that while we were talking, the conversation was so interesting. I didn't even realize we're almost coming towards the top of the hour, and we probably have time just for one question. And I'm going to club it with a question that's come from the audience. So two things. One, the audience question that came, I thought was a very nice one, which said, so is this digital moment of pharma? So has pharma's digital moment really arrived? So I'd like to get your thoughts on it, along with saying that many of the things that we have seen as changes, which have happened because of pandemic, do you see those continuing? Whether it's things like work from home or hybrid working models, collaboration tools being used, to all the way what we are seeing through the supply chain, through doctors engaging with their patients and whatever, from across the value chain perspective in terms of changes that you have seen, how much do you see them continuing in different parts of the value chain? And do you also see that this is, if you're saying that this is going to be the way it is, are you seeing that digital has really arrived in pharma? So I hope that made sense in terms of what the question was. I will turn it across to each of you to share your last thoughts and crystal gazing, if you will, around it.
Yes, certainly, I think digital is arrived at the pharma, though the pharma industry was called as a lagger in the digitalization. I think the speed which we have taken in adoption is very impressive. I think we are at a par with any other industry, like BFSI may be a little ahead, but rest other industries, we are at a par. The digitalization, and I think the change in pandemic, the real challenge now would be retention of the workforces. Because the change in pandemic has created a realization of having a work-life balance almost in every individual. I'm not talking only about the pharmaceutical industry, but across all the industries, and you might have seen the data, the changeover which is happening at a magnitude of 10 to 30% during this last couple of months is a symbol of people are thinking differently. One where the period where people were having a job for survival, people were having a job for leisure, but now people would like to have a job for managing their lifestyle, or rather managing the work-life balance. I think that is where the technology is going to work a lot. The way we are discussing about, there are certain companies which are already starting and thinking about having a hybrid environment forever. But of course, it would get mature because this is happening for the first time in the organization history. So there would be a lot of learning curves which would be there in the future for each and every organization. But I think this is another thought which is coming in workforce. And I think this is a game changer probably for most of the organization, because you can't really attract a challenge only basis of certain elements of your company, right? You really need to think about a new thought, what a new workforce is thinking on. I think this is one of the area where digital is going to help a lot. At the same time, as I touched upon initially, the connectivity, accessibility and everything, you really need to have a very nice digital framework to secure your environment. We have not touched upon the cybersecurity part, but I think, again, that is the one area where we have to dwell upon. And when we are working on a hybrid environment, there are a lot of obligations you need to think of, and you need to coordinate yourself with a lot of technology measure where each and every point of digital would be touched upon by each and every element. And that is where I think the whole piece of cybersecurity would come in. So all in all, I think digitalization is there. We are part of digitalization. I think this is a scale which we need to adopt, and every organization would have a different pace and a speed to adopt the digitalization. That is my thought, Ganesh, at this point in time.
Thanks so much, Sanjay. Abdul?
Yes, I would say emphatic yes now, not that it was never there. Now the digitalization as a thought and acceptance, I would say more than thought, and it's an acceptance, has gone from gone to the top management as well as the middle management. So there is a slight acceptance, and this is going to be a future. So, and you see the ecosystem around that is also getting built, which was, I don't think, a couple of years we had providers giving use cases and so on and so forth. So we have a ample number of the providers. I think internal ecosystem, both internal and external providers, are getting ready to it, which is where I think slowly mindset is changing. And of course, technology will come. There will be challenges. There are opportunities, but we need to embrace it, and it's going to be there. And this time we will see more digital happening in the operations excellence. That's the next step. We have already seen on the IT or customer facing side, but we will get the feel of Pharma 4.0 now, where quality, manufacturing, and R&D is going to drastically change the way we operate and the way we look at it.
Sure. Super. Gyan?
Well, very well summarized by thanks for listening. We'll say, I'll be very specific to the two questions. Is it the time for a digital pharma? Very emphatically, yes. As always, said, yes. And this is not something which is getting induced by the other verticals. It is basically the business reset, and everyone is in the kind of adoption sooner or later. So the degree of distillation could vary, but it's not a kind of a choice, it's a mandate where you have to go. With respect to not only for being distilled, which brings you the process excellence, but also to become market competitive, quality compliance, and to be in the business, you have to adopt and invest.
And pharma, of course, there has been slight hesitations earlier on the sides of the operations, whether it is quality, R&D, and operations. But I think now those departments and functions are more demanding, and IT has to basically come out and implement that. The point which Adhut very rightly mentioned, that okay, there was always sometimes it also get laggard, or that there was a lack of strong conviction because of the ecosystem was not supporting, whether it is from the solution side, partner side, network side, or your technology compatibility side. So now you can, if some technology is obsolete, you can still install external sensors, you can still capture the data, you can still basically integrate that, data exchange can happen. So that is no more a kind of limitations. And the digital mindset, now when we talk about millennials, they are already a kind of with a data consuming mindset, and they want everything on the digital format. So that is definitely going to change. And more than that, the healthcare space, and when we talk about life sciences in general, there are more use cases and opportunities in the future in order to make our life better. And that is only possible by adopting the neo-digital technologies. And that will also pressurize to go on the adoption of digital. And going forward in the future, what we talk about, the personalized medications and personalized medicines delivery, all this will happen. But to start with the journey, yes, we have started, and this digital run all the marathon will go, and rather this marathon will become 100 meter sprint, and that will be fragmented into different pieces. Yes.
Thank you so much, Gyan. So, you know, I've been making some furious notes on the points that all of you were making. And so I think just for the audience, I think what we did cover over the last hour or so was a fascinating perspective on what all are the areas where automation has seen an increase, and what are new things that are likely to emerge. So we touched pretty much across the value chain. You heard about things that were coming in from the part of the front office, which anyway has seen transformation, to going all the way behind. And I think increasingly what we heard from the panel was that you will see more automation. You are likely to be seeing more areas which are coming up for digitization towards the back office side, as you go towards manufacturing, quality, R&D, and integrating all of these together. It's not that it was not there earlier, but they were silos. You are likely to see more of it happening where you're getting all of this to come together. A lot more analytics coming in and basic amount of things coming to say, how can you help people to make decisions better? We also heard the one that Abdut was mentioning on saying that it is now about the three areas that people need to look at, which is going through the areas on the mindset, which is going through the skill set, and looking at saying that by doing all of these, when you're going through on the mindset, skill set, and the people set areas, how do you really kind of take it across? Gyan spoke about the parts where he looked at saying that there is more optimization that is possible and it is needed today, because you are looking to say that how can I get better cash flows? How can I get better performance improvements? And this is not something that IT is trying to do on itself. It is a business requirement, which was the point that Sanjay as well alluded to, which is saying that it has to be a lot more about collaboration and the need to really break mindsets. And while doing all this, while we didn't talk about it at length, do all of it in a secure manner, because in today's world, cybersecurity and ensuring that you have all this coming in a manner where security by design is embedded into the process is something that is critical. I hope you enjoyed the panel discussion as much as I enjoyed interacting with the panel. Thank you once again for being part of this. And thank you, Team Elitz, for having us in the discussion.
Thank you so much, sir. And allow me to say that is probably one of the most enriching and engaging discussions that I've heard in a very long time. And I clearly didn't want it to end so soon. And of course, the thought of skill set, mindset, and people set is going on the board for sure. So thank you so much for all your presence. And we would like to have a small token from the Elitz Digital Pharma Summit team for taking out your valuable time. So there's a certificate for Dr. Avdhoot Parab for sharing.
Thank you.
To Mr. Gyan Pandey for your presence here, sir. Then for Mr. Sanjay, for your deep thoughts. And of course, Mr. Ramachandran for driving this discussion in this very organized manner and giving us insights into this, you know, thought of the future. Thank you so much, all of you, for your presence.
Thank you.
We would now be heading into another break and regroup at 3:45 p.m. for our next discussion on COVID-19 implications for pharma R&D, building for the next normal. Thank you so much, all of you.